A geologist who's been visiting the same cliff face in Greenland every summer for some 20 years has noticed a big change in the landscape. Where he once crossed icy ground to reach his research site, in more recent years he's crossed a sandy beach. For him, there is no question. Climate change is an observable, established fact. With an eye on the human condition, this is Insight. According to the journal Nature, in 2023, Greenland recorded its highest temperature in 1,000 years. The article concludes that human activity has contributed to a warming trend that began in 1800 and could have far-reaching effects. At the same time, the 2023 global temperature was also the hottest on record, 1.4 degrees Celsius, above pre-industrial levels, benchmarked at 1850 through 1900. In 174 years of record keeping, the last 9 have been the warmest, adding to concerns about rising sea levels and record-breaking concentrations of greenhouse gases. In earth science terms, a tipping point is a critical threshold that, when crossed, leads to large accelerating and often irreversible changes in the climate. A recent article published in Nature gives this dire warning. The evidence from tipping points alone suggests we are in a state of planetary emergency, where both the risk and urgency of the situation are acute. Climate change has become a political football, and the debate has become so acrimonious that meteorologists in several countries have suffered harassment and even death threats for their on-air comments on climate change. On one side, some dismiss the human impact, believing that we can have little effect on such a massive Earth system. They say that no amount of increase in greenhouse gas emissions can cause such a change. Others, however, counter with historical evidence. For example, the warming trend that's playing out in Greenland was accurately predicted back in 1972. In an article published that year in Nature, meteorologist John S. Sawyer accurately predicted an increase in atmospheric carbon dioxide and a corresponding rise in global temperature of 0.6 degrees Celsius by the year 2000. The actual temperature increase was 0.5 degrees Celsius. Although Sawyer acknowledged at the time that much more research was needed, his prediction made 50 years prior was correct. But the idea of a link between global warming and heat trapped in the atmosphere was not new even then. It had been proposed in the previous century by French scientist Joseph Fourier. In 1824, he noticed that the Earth was warmer than its distance from the sun suggests, and he concluded that the atmosphere was storing heat. At the end of that century, Swedish chemist Svante Arrhenius observed that carbon dioxide, or CO2, in the atmosphere was effectively trapping heat and predicted that the huge increase in burning coal for industrial purposes would increase atmospheric CO2 and warm the planet. In 1958, U.S. scientist Charles Keeling linked the rising amount of CO2 to the growth of the human population. In 1750, it was less than 280 parts per million, rising exponentially along with world population and industrialization to about 420 parts per million by 2020. In this illustration, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, represented by the blue line, has increased along with human emissions, the gray line, since the start of the Industrial Revolution in 1750. Emissions rose slowly to about 5 gigatons. 1 gigaton is a billion metric tons per year in the mid-20th century, before skyrocketing to more than 35 billion metric tons per year by the end of the century. From this 200-year history of the role of heat in the atmosphere, we can certainly see that human activity is implicated in climate change. And unlike today, this history shows no politicization of the issue, nor any suggestion by others of deception or hoax on the part of the scientists involved. But even more compelling proof exists from our distant past. Ancient air bubbles trapped in ice enable us to step back in time and see what Earth's atmosphere and climate were like centuries earlier. They tell us that levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere are higher than they have been at any time in the past 400,000 years. This graph not only conveys the scientific measurements, it also underscores the fact that humans have a great capacity to change the climate and the planet. In 2023, the UN Climate Change Conference, COP28, discussed ways to control the problems caused by global warming. 196 nations had signed the 2015 COP21 Paris Agreement and had set a goal of limiting global temperature increase to no more than 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. The UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change assesses the science behind climate change. They confirm with high confidence that global warming is likely to reach 1.5 degrees Celsius between 2030 and 2052 if it continues to increase at the current rate. Unfortunately, nations have so far failed to live up to their 2015 commitments, creating what the late climatologist Will Steffen and others have called a planetary emergency. The fact that little has been achieved despite previous commitments to agreed targets perhaps speaks to the lack of willingness to change on the part of some fossil fuel producers and top users. They form a powerful lobby and show little inclination to promote an end to fossil fuel dependency, preferring to talk in terms of phasing down rather than phasing out. Russia, Saudi Arabia, and China do not support an immediate end to fossil fuel use. And while COP28 ended with a communique that spoke of ending fossil fuel dependency, it remains to be seen whether that goal can be achieved in time. Right now, the problem isn't just that the world is getting hotter and hotter. It's that we may have set off a global tipping cascade, in the words of Steffen and his colleagues. In 2019, they noted that 9 of the 15 known global climate tipping points that regulate the state of the planet have been activated. Another example of a tipping point causing the sudden release of CO2 and methane into the atmosphere would be the irreversible thawing of Arctic permafrost. Accordingly, Steffen said, we are already deep into the trajectory towards collapse of civilization. That is, whether or not we succeed in reducing emissions, it may already be too late to prevent a hothouse Earth. Ahead of COP28, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres sent a video message to the more than 200 participants of the Global Faith Leaders Summit, who'd gathered in Dubai to discuss climate change. He said, we need the moral voice and spiritual authority of faith leaders globally to summon the conscience of world leaders, awaken their ambition, and inspire them to do what is needed. But human nature, left to its own devices, is unlikely to come to the negotiating table with moral ethical priorities at the forefront. Self-interest usually wins out. Could radical change still bring a reprieve? Despite all that lies ahead, there is hope.
I'm a climate scientist.
Kate Marvel, a lead author of the U.S. 5th National Climate Assessment, recently gave some reason for optimism. She said, extreme events like heat waves, floods, and droughts are becoming more severe and frequent, exactly as we predicted they would. We were proved right. But she adds, in the last decade, the cost of wind energy has declined by 70%, and solar has declined 90%. Renewables now make up 80% of new electricity generation capacity. Our country's greenhouse gas emissions are falling, even as our GDP and population grow. The glimmer of hope she sees is that the United States has responded to climate change warnings at state, local, and tribal levels. But she acknowledges that more people need to get on board. Understanding and acting on what the future holds for our children and grandchildren and future generations, if the 1.5 degree C target is exceeded, is the moral and ethical imperative we must meet. A quote often attributed to German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer declares, "The ultimate test of a moral society is the kind of world that it leaves to its children." And as several authors have shown, there are practical steps we can all take to make a positive impact. For example, Julian Cribb's How to Fix a Broken Planet, Advice for Surviving the 21st Century, details several personal strategies for cooling the Earth. The most immediate contribution we can make, he says, is to lower our personal consumption of everything, especially consumer goods, textiles and clothing, items of machinery and equipment, building materials, travel and transport, goods imported from far away, and luxury foods, and recycle more and waste less. It is our overconsumption of goods that is the chief driver of climate change, and we have to get it under control, or else rob our grandchildren of their future on a habitable planet. This is our urgent moral duty. Leaders and industrialists have their part to play. Instead of engaging in short-term thinking and political and economic compromise, they must act now for the greater long-term good. What is certain is that without immediate action, we will condemn our descendants and all life post-2100 to a catastrophic fate at 3 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. They deserve better, and we can all do better. If you'd like to know more, go to our website, vision.org, and search for Hope for Humanity. For Insight, I'm David Hulme.